Literacy, Language, and Technology Research Group at Portland State University. And you may have seen her name or even seen her present. She does so frequently on this topic and has some really good resources and information to share. And then our very own Heather Surrency, who manages our health and financial literacy initiatives here at FLC, who has also done some work on digital literacy, especially as it pertains to health literacy. And of course, that she took the lead on developing, that she'll be sharing some information about. So with that, I'd like to ask each of you, if you don't mind, to just in the chat, introduce yourself, the folks who are participating today. And if you could also mention a digital literacy related challenge that that either you or your students have experienced. So if you can add that to the chat, that'll help us to kind of get things kicked off here. So with that, I'd like to turn it over to Kathy. So take it away, Kathy.
All right, thanks so much, Greg. All right, so today I'm participating. Thank you very much for inviting me to participate today in digital literacy and adult learning. I'm gonna do this first part. And as Greg said, I'm Kathy Harris, and I'm from Portland, Oregon. I'm at Portland State University. I'm an applied linguist, and I'm in the Literacy, Language, and Technology Research Group. So I'm here to talk about a topic that is near and dear to my heart. So what I'm going to be talking about today is thinking about what is digital literacy really? What does this mean for instruction? And how can states and programs support digital literacy acquisition? So that's what I want to talk about today. So to give us a start in talking about what is digital literacy really, I'm going to add to what Greg is having you do. And I want you to, in the chat, to start listing just in popcorn fashion or just in you know, as fast as you can in whatever fashion you want to. What are all of the things that you do in a day that are digital? I want you to start from the moment you wake up. So, and everyone, look at your chat and see, as people start putting in the chat, what do you do from the moment you wake up that's digital? For example, and just start putting it in the chat. Exactly, alarm clock on their iPhone. I mean, the first thing I do when I wake up is reach for my phone to see what time it is. So I want you to all look, what are the things that you do in a day that are digital? And I'm gonna shut up for a minute while people have a few minutes to put things into the chat. Check the weather, absolutely. Meditation, What are some other things people do? Oh yeah, listening to music while they're exercising, exercising to videos. Teach virtually, absolutely. And as your day progresses, what are the things that you need to do that are digital? Anybody check their bank account online? Look at their calendar? Order groceries, for sure. Do their shopping, yep. What are some other, check your accounts, check your calendar for sure, yep. Right? You might need to fill out the forms if you're going to go to, I'm going to a doctor's appointment later. I've got to fill out all these forms online to get ready for the appointment. Social media, to catch up with friends. Yep. Discuss your day with Alexa. I love that, Susan. Yep. You might use your, transferring funds. How many, now with COVID, it's harder, but you know, when I need to go somewhere, I'll often use maps to make sure there's no traffic where on my route. Apply for health insurance, right? Oh, and that's tough. My daughter just turned 26. Oh my goodness. Using the marketplace was an interesting experience. Yeah. Okay, well MapQuest. Everybody keep going. Excellent. I want you all, while I start talking about digital literacy, to be thinking about all these things that you all do that are digital and that our students need to be able to do. Okay. So when we start thinking about digital literacy, we often think about basic or foundational digital skills. The things, how to turn on a device, how to open a browser, how to check your email, how to open a document, create a document, save a document, find it again after you saved it, right? That can be tricky for people who are new to digital literacy. Open a browser, open a different browser, open a new tab. Send an email, send an attachment with an email. So these are some of the things that are part of the foundational digital skills, right? Oops, other way. Well, encompassing those basic or foundational digital skills is the next layer of digital literacies, which are to create and communicate information. So if you think about all of the things you need to be able to do in communicating information, we use email, secure messaging systems, social media to communicate with our friends, with our family, and so on. We create information as well, and I'll be talking a little bit about that. We write blogs, we make media, sometimes make media, and so on. In addition, including all of those things, and then in addition, we find and evaluate information, right? So we need to be able to find the information we're looking for and evaluate its veracity. Is this information reliable? Is this what I need to know? Do I need to compare it with another source of information, right? And I think Heather will talk a lot about that as well. Oops, I keep going the wrong direction. So including all of those things, in addition, is digital problem solving. That is solving problems in digital environments. This idea of sometimes it's the digital itself that's the problem. So think about when you sign on in the morning and you need to do something, all of a sudden, let's say that web page is broken, which you don't know that it's broken, it's just not doing what you think it should be doing. Or you log into something else and all of a sudden they've updated their interface and you can't figure out how it is that you're trying can do the thing you want to do. So sometimes the digital tool itself is the problem, but more often we're problem solving in a digital environment. So think about if you're trying to buy a used car, you need to look at what are the cars available? Where are they in my area? I might need to look at a map program to see where are those cars. This one's available here, this one's available over there. Then you might need to go to Consumer Reports or some other kind of evaluation service to see the car that you're looking at. What is it? What are the problems associated with that car? What is its gas mileage, et cetera? And then you look at the price and you might make some kind of a table that compares the information from those different sources to see which car is the best car for me to buy with what I have and so on. So their digital problem solving involves finding and evaluating information, creating and communicating information, and basic digital skills. So a working definition of digital problem solving is the ability to navigate and use multiple digital resources in order to accomplish a goal, and in multiple domains, including professional work, personal interests, educational pursuits, social or professional networking, and civic areas, and key, and I'll come back to this a bunch of times today, or future uses we have not yet conceptualized. All right, so think about all the domains of life that are in the list that you generated on the chat. You think about all the domains of life that have digital literacies needed. We need digital skills for these things. We need digital skills to enroll our kids in school, to communicate with their teacher, to read the school calendar, move my little bar, to help them with their homework, or these days to help them with online school, right? And so we need to fill out personnel forms. We need to find and apply for jobs, communicate with colleagues at work. That might be through email, through messaging, or it might be using a project management. It's like Basecamp, Slack, Trello, these different project management systems that you communicate within. And we might need to make presentations to colleagues or clients. And these are all things our students need to be able to do too, right? We might need to enroll ourselves in school. That's all digital. Working in groups is remote, so now that's digital. Conducting research, which we need to find and evaluate information. Making presentations to our class. These are all digital, have digital skills required. Filling out medical forms, getting accurate health information, communicating with our providers, and accessing our patient portal are all things that our students need to be able to do, that we need to be able to do, that require digital literacies. So it also requires language skills. Let's see if I can get through here. So for those of you who are working with English language learners, digital literacies and English literacies are just deeply entwined, right? So you need English writing skills, or whatever language, the context of the language that you're working with, you need to be able to write in that language to communicate with the child's teacher, with your child's teacher, whether that be through text, through email, or through their, let's say they have a communication platform on their website, which some schools do. Searching for jobs requires reading skills, and a lot of the things on here require reading skills, where you need to read and evaluate information online in order to decide which jobs to apply for. When you're doing research to learn about something, let's say in my example on buying a used car, to do your research, you need to read. But also when you're reading online and when you're using digital tools to read, reading is like authoring. And let me tell you how that works. So you're reading an article, let's say you're reading an article about a car, and there's a link to the specifics of the gas mileage. So you're gonna click on that link and go to the next article. When you've finished getting the information you want from that article, some people are gonna come back to their original article, and some people are gonna follow another link and go to the next article, or the next, or the next. They might go to reviews. So the idea is everybody, even though they start with that initial review of that car, is gonna end up reading something different. They have authored their own reading. So reading online is like authoring your reading, and that's a different skill. So that's a language skill. And evaluating information, when we're getting accurate, when we wanna get health information, we have to evaluate. Is this where I should get information? Is it good information? Can I trust this information? So what we see is there is an intertwining between language literacies and digital literacies. They're inseparable. And digital literacies are in all realms and all elements, or nearly all elements of our lives. It's hard to see these days an element or a realm of our life that doesn't have digital literacies required for participation. All right, so that's where we are with respect to thinking about how integrated digital literacy is into life. So there's a couple of things to think about. Many people come to the task of integrating digital literacy into their instruction thinking, oh, the younger people in my classes, they're going to be fine. They already know how to use technology, right? So some people think about that. On the other hand, people say, oh, if I've got students in my class who are older, or maybe if I'm older, I'm going to really struggle with learning how to do things with technology. But those are both really problematic statements. What we find instead is that youth in the United States are among the lowest, they're in the bottom third of the ability to have strong digital literacies, among the bottom third of countries in the world. And those are recent studies, among the lowest. We're in the lowest third. So no, younger people in the US are not as good as technology as people think. And it's also true that Silver Surfers, our older community members are better at, some of them are better at digital literacies than people think. So Silver Surfers are, so at least younger, higher income, and more educated seniors use the internet and broadband at rates approaching or exceeding the general population. They are online often, are online daily, and they use social networks for all kinds of purposes. Now, that drops significantly after the age of 75, but until that age, depending on the social, depending on age and income, the older people are using the internet well and often. So we have to think about, well, how do we want to think about what digital literacy really is then if we've questioned some of those assumptions? Well, we really have to think about digital literacy as a continuum from the ability to power up a device and send a text message up through creating and saving a document, making a multimedia document, collaborating online, solving problems in digital environments. And key to this, and the point I really want to emphasize here, is there's an arrow on the right. The emerging digital literacy. Technology is always changing and will always change. What that means is with technology, everyone is a learner. And so because everyone's a learner, that has a lot of implications for us as teachers. We can't always be the one who knows as a teacher. Sometimes what we have to do is instead of being the sage on the stage, we really have to step aside and be the guide on the side. To be the facilitation of learning that we as teachers know how to do. We know how to facilitate learning. That is our superpower. And so we need to think about digital literacy integrated into the literacies that we use in our classroom and that we teach in our classroom. But we have to approach that a little bit differently. We have to approach that knowing that many of the students in our classes are going to have a patchwork of skills. Some are going to know how to do things, others don't. Some are going to know how to do things the teacher doesn't. But nonetheless, no one is going to know it all. Everyone is always going to be a learner, and we need to approach it that way. So what does this mean for instruction? Well, it means a couple of different things. But to start off, what I have to say is using technology in the classroom in and of itself does not produce better outcomes. So it's not just that it's technology that's the magic here. That's not the case. Instead, what we need to do as teachers is to think a little bit about what are our goals? How do I support digital literacy acquisition in my classroom? Well, what we need to do is think about it in a couple of different ways. First of all, we need to support the development of new digital literacy skills a couple of times. We want as much as possible to use a device, have each person use a device when they need it, doing the things that they are doing, right? So device here is important. Get a device in a person's hand. So when they need it, so it's a just-in-time thing. When they need it, it's there. Don't just use technology for drills and practice, but instead use it to promote critical thinking and problem solving. So the idea is, and we know how to do this as teachers, we meet students where they are. So when you've got something a person is confident about, that's when you can introduce a digital literacy and push that learning, push the development of new skills in an area they're already confident about. And when there is an area that they are not very confident about, you want to first do that with more teacher-led activities as opposed to introducing something new. And we know how to do that as teachers, right? We don't pile new on new on new when we're facilitating learning. We take what people know and add something to it. We don't do new things and then new things on top of new things. And so that's important to remember with technology. And most importantly, what I'll talk about a little bit more, is that technology should align with the content learning objectives. We don't want to use tools for its own sake, because tools or digital tools and technology on their own, just by the virtue of their existence, does not improve learning outcomes. Instead, we want to avoid what I call the cool tools, I'll air quote it, cool tools problem. This problem where there is a technology, therefore I must use it. So what are the things I can do with that technology? That's the cool tools problem. Instead, what is my outcome that I'm going for in this class? What are my students' goals? What are our program goals? And how can a tool support that goal? So that's important. And some of the ways to look at that to help to keep your tool use and your technology integration supporting your goals for the class and the learning outcomes that your program is going for is use one of these models. You can use the TPAC is the technological, pedagogical content knowledge. So what is it that teachers need to know? We have technology knowledge, content knowledge, and then we have pedagogical knowledge. How is it that people learn? And so that's a framework for thinking about technology integration. Or the SAMR model, which is another way to think about how do we move up from technology to including technology in a way that supports student learning and content learning objectives. Or now what I really like is a triple E framework, which is really a way to think about instructional strategies and thinking about how to enhance, extend, and engage towards our instructional, using instructional strategies to support our learning outcomes. So these are ways that you can help kind of stay focused on your learning objectives. Okay, so the other thing to think about is use what students already know. You know, as I mentioned, we all as teachers, we don't pile new upon new upon new. So we take what students already know. For example, even in their other language, in their other languages. So we might use text. If people know how to text in a variety of languages or their other languages, use texting as a device for some of the new English that they're learning, right? So you can also use it to nudge people, to remind them of things. You can do micro, sign them up for cell ed or a kind of project where you can use a cell phone for micro learning, learning small lessons. If people are using social media, use social media in your classroom. Use it to accomplish your goals, but use a tool that they're already really familiar with. Because research has shown that even with beginning levels of print literacy, people can use social, it is possible for people to use social media to interact with others and have critical literacy skills and communication skills being developed while using this tool. And then my question marks here on the farthest one is because we don't know what the next tool will be. It used to be Facebook was big. Now it's Facebook is used by some, but other forms of social media are used by others. So we have to always stay with what do our students need? What do our students also need to be able to do, but what are the tools they already use and leverage those tools? We need to make technology use relevant. So not technology outside of its context. So when we're talking about how do you fill out forms, you need to talk about where do you fill out forms. So when you're doing your unit on education and training, say use those forms to do digital form filling. So that's the idea. The other thing that I want to really emphasize is that even though many people think of that technology as when you're using technology, you don't need as many people around. And I really have found in the research that we're doing and the research of others that that's not at all the case. There needs to be a lot of human connection when it comes to digital literacy acquisition. When someone's learning a new skill, when learners are struggling, especially when they're struggling, because who doesn't struggle with technology sometimes, right? Sometimes it's inexplicable why it's not working. It just makes no sense as to how it might or might not work. So when people are learning a new skill or when they're struggling, that's when people need to encourage them. They need to say, you could do this. No, let me show you how, or let me give you a guidance on what to try. But yeah, keep at it. It's fine. You know, you'll be able to do this. So these are the times when humans are really important. They're important to be cheerleaders. They're important to help point people in new directions. But it's also humans are important here to help learners find relevance, because it's really easy for people to say, I don't need to do this, so I don't want to do it. But how will it be help? How can you help the learners? How can others help the learners to see how doing these things, doing the digital literacy, doing the things in the digital environment are relevant to their lives? Whether it's finding music that they really like, whether it's using social media to communicate with relatives who live far away, there are things that help people do the things that they want to do. So humans are important in this realm. And then lastly, you want to provide opportunities for your learners to create content. And this has such power for project-based learning, problem-based learning that we've been doing for so long. We've been doing project-based learning since the 80s, right? So similar to the same skills that people learn when they do project-based learning on paper and pencil, whether an example being, you know, you have people do research on a medical condition and they make a poster, right? We've done that kind of project-based learning for a long time in adult education. But now what we're saying is, why not use digital media skills? They could make an infographic, and your students can make an infographic. Your students can make a blog. They can create a presentation on Google Sheets, Google Slides or PowerPoint. They can make a video. And even if a teacher doesn't know how to do those, I wouldn't necessarily know how to do those things. Someone in the class might, a tutor in your program might, or you can all learn together, because there's lots of good ways to learn online. But giving people the opportunity and the skills to create content provides the opportunity for people to share their voice, to be able to have a voice in their communities, to be able to participate in the civic life in their community. And that's really important. So providing opportunities to create content is an important aspect of digital literacy. Now, there are quite a few, my time is up, and I have quite a few resources, and I will be putting them in the chat as Heather gets started talking. But for now, what I'd like to do is to say thank you very much for your attention, and I would like to turn this over to Heather Sorensy, who is going to be taking us on the next step of our journey today.
Thanks so much, Kathy. That was a lot of great information. And I'm going to kind of, you know, take what Kathy said and roll a little bit more specifically into digital health literacy. So right now in the chat, I am going to put a shared Word document. I have put some of my favorite resources on that document, and I encourage you to do the same. So this is a real-time document that you can add, and everybody can see the resources that you put on there. So Kathy, if you want to add yours to that list, we can kind of make a group list of great resources, because I know each one of you probably have resources that I have never heard of and I haven't used before. So I would appreciate us all using that together. And then I do have some project-based learning activities that I can add on that document after our webinar as well. So to introduce myself again, I'm Heather Sorensy. I'm the Health and Financial Literacy Coordinator at FLC. It's great to see so many familiar faces. We welcome you to our webinar today. And as I said, I'm going to kind of zone in a little bit on some of the work that we're doing at FLC and how that might affect your students. So let me share my screen. One moment, says I. All right, can everybody see that? All right, great. Okay, so I just first wanted to touch on digital knowledge as it really does vary by educational attainment, as Kathy was saying. This is some research that was done by Pew, and really just kind of looking at some specific topics within digital literacy to assess understanding. Can everybody see my screen? It keeps telling me that you can't.
You can see it.
Okay, great. Thank you for confirmation. So it's kind of giving us the general idea that when we look at US adults who have high school or less education, that they are significantly, or they're understanding some of this digital literacy information at a significantly lower level than those who have some college or have received a bachelor's or even a master's degree. So you can take just a moment to look at some of these. On the chart on the right, it kind of shows you the difference between people who have high school or less, all the way to the top of, or to the right-hand side of this continuum, people who have a college degree. So, you know, understanding what cookies do and that they allow websites to track user visits would be one topic that could definitely be discussed and examined. For my purposes, this is a huge one, that advertising is the largest source of revenue for most social media platforms. Many Americans do not understand how social media platforms are making money. And we're going to talk about that as we go along, but it's such an integral part of why they even exist. So a lot of this is about privacy or understanding what, you know, HTTPS is versus without the S.
Hey, Heather, People are asking if you will go ahead and play the slideshow so it can make the screen a little bit bigger.
Okay, you don't see that?
They can see it, but it's really tiny. So if you just go, if you go ahead and go to view this, or what is it, slide, go to slideshow and go from this slide.
I'm going to stop bigger. How I'm sharing it. I think that might be the problem.
Do you have two screens, Heather?
I do. It's my second screen.
Yeah, you got to swap presentation.
Let's see if that works better. How's that?
There we go.
Yep. Okay, sorry about that. Thank you. See, we all have things to learn, right? Especially the dual screen, that always messes me up. And it is still a small graphic, and I will put the link to this graphic in the chat so that you can take a look at it. Another topic that was on here, you know, people knowing that Facebook owns WhatsApp and Instagram, and they're acquiring more and more digital products all of the time, you know, understanding what phishing scams are. So, you know, I just wanted to kind of give you an idea that even among college-educated Americans, there's still a lot for us to learn kind of just about the digital systems, much less the digital literacy. When we look at the impact of COVID, you know, we don't have a lot of good data. I would love to know more about what percent of adult learners are, you know, using mobile devices, are using social media, or getting information online. And we still have a lot of research to do in that area, but we know that overall in the US, during kind of the pandemic, we saw a huge increase in online consumption. So this graph on the right shows you the percent of consumers that increased their time spent on each channel during the pandemic. And again, it's nearly doubled from 2019 to 2020 and likely continued to grow into 2021. But we see people using social media more, getting more news from apps and websites. Streaming services, of course, were huge. A lot of content came out, TV and video and mobile games. So this kind of freaked me out when I saw it the first time. This is what's happening in the digital landscape every minute of the day. The average American in 2020 was spending 25% of their waking time on mobile devices. And you know, kind of to go along with that, we saw mobile ad placements jumping by 70%. So there's a lot of area for us, I think, to address this in terms of digital health literacy, media literacy, and kind of understanding these systems. And again, it's all happening because of money, right? And so helping people understand what that corporate piece is can help us to evaluate information. And I'm not gonna go through all of these, but you get the general idea of how much content is being is being made. So tell me, how many of you have ever searched online for health information? And maybe tell me in the chat, if you don't mind, like what was the last thing that you searched for? I would guess for a lot of people, it might be COVID-related information, but I'd love to see in the chat, what are some other topics that you have looked for online? Yeah, COVID test results, definitely. As I said, I think that's probably a really common one. When can I take a shower after I have stitches? Yeah, so it can be kind of basic things like that. We all know getting instructions from healthcare providers, sometimes we forget when we get home, so we can get some more information about that. A lot of people are saying medication information, another good topic. So overall, I think that health information is just confusing, especially news. My father-in-law used to tease me all the time about caffeine, because if you have followed the research on caffeine over the last 15 or 20 years, it has drastically changed. Sometimes caffeine is good for you, sometimes caffeine is bad for you, and it kind of can flip-flop around sometimes. A lot of that is because just because there's one study or one pilot small study, that doesn't mean that it's fact, right? That just kind of is the impetus for other people to start researching a health topic. So unfortunately, sometimes our news outlets will pick up that one small study and portray it as fact when we need to be doing larger research, it needs to be double blind and things like that, right? So I think caffeine was a great example that we look at a body of research over time and then we can make recommendations from there. But I think that we do a disservice to consumers because it does get so confusing and kind of feels like this, that people are just, you know, kind of spinning the wheel. So we as educators want to try to help people kind of move through some of that static or noise to find good information that does have research behind it. Thanks for you that are still putting it in the chat. I'm seeing a lot of great topics, definitely statin drugs, diabetes, diseases like Parkinson's. And there's so much that we can learn that is high quality information, but how do we find it? And how do we help our learners find it is always the question. So for most of us, you know, we're looking for healthy living tips, maybe answering some of these health questions as you're listening in the chat. Maybe we want to get a refill on a prescription. With the portals now, I had a mammogram last week, for instance, and I could look at my results right on the portal without even talking to my doctor. So a lot of us can do things like that, or look at instructions from a doctor or a nurse and even have a conversation perhaps on your mobile device. We can also find affordable, good healthcare near us in our community. So 67.5% to 81.5%, like there's different studies have different numbers. This percent of American adults have looked online for health related information, and that has gone up a lot in the last 5 or 10 years. It used to be below 50%. And again, I mean, I think through COVID, even more and more people now are getting their information digitally. But there are a lot of potential problems with that. First of all, becoming convinced of a self-diagnosis when it's not confirmed by a doctor. I don't know if anybody's felt that before, but you kind of look at signs and symptoms, you're like, oh my gosh, I must have this terrible disease, which can cause people to have unnecessary stress, maybe getting additional tests from their doctor that they didn't need. Sometimes we can kind of get confirmation bias too by looking at different sites that support our point of view, and maybe even try some dangerous treatments as a result of our fear and stress about a particular condition. At the bottom, I define for you, there's an actual term, cyberchondriacs, who are people that chronically are trying to self-diagnose their symptoms and then initiate their own treatment by conducting research online and then purchasing those treatments online. And that definitely could be very dangerous situation when we're ordering things online that aren't through the traditional medical system. We don't know what products we're getting. We don't know how they might be harmful for our particular symptoms or conditions. Even credible information can be misinterpreted or misunderstood. So that's another issue. Like we might read something and draw some conclusions or make some assumptions that are not correct. And then also we have so many inequities in our access to healthcare in the US. And that can encourage people to rely on digital health information as their primary healthcare source. And that again is dangerous too, right? So maybe I don't have the money to go to the doctor or I don't have the money to go to the emergency room. And so I try to figure out another way to solve my problem But you know, for certain symptoms, they always require an examination by a healthcare practitioner. So we want to kind of use digital health information as a supplement to talking with our doctors and nurses versus as a replacement. So at FLC, we have felt like this is really an important topic. So I hope most of you saw that we released this fall a course. It's a self-paced course and it's aimed at students. It can be used in the classroom, kind of as an instructor resource, or it could even potentially be used by students on their own. This is kind of the first screen just to give you an idea. And it's really aimed at lower level learners who are just trying to start to understand more about digital health literacy. Put it on that I put in the chat, but it's an tool to help adult learners, you know, build both their digital health literacy skills, clicking, answering questions, you know, navigating through it. You can see here, this is a picture or a screenshot of it. And on the left, you can see that there is a menu. So they have to kind of figure out how to navigate through that. There's hands-on activities and quizzes as well. We do assume a basic computer skill level to be able to complete this course. So if you have a student that does not feel confident with their basic skills, we encourage them to complete the North Star Basic Computer Skills online module first. And we do have a link at the beginning of the course for students to be able to access that. So they really have to be able to, you know, click, drag, and use those basic types of mouse and keyboard skills to take the course. The topics that we include, how to use an internet browser, how to make bookmarks in the browser, how to find quality health information through an internet search, how to find trustworthy websites that you can go to directly, paying for healthcare, telehealth basics, and then we have a downloadable resource page at the end of the course. So as I kind of talk today just about digital health literacy, I'm kind of using the course as a framework so you can gain some additional information yourself and then kind of see how our course works. So again, just to remember for you, as well as if you're talking about this topic with your learners, we never want a website to replace what a doctor or nurse recommends for seeking medical attention. So where do we find high quality health information? I think the two areas that we can talk to adult learners about are searching using a browser and then also going directly to a trusted website. So personally, I really would like to direct people to trusted websites. We're going to talk about some websites that are very comprehensive and address almost every major health topic. And that's a much easier way to find information. But I realize that a lot of adult learners are probably using Google too. So I think we should try to provide some basic skills to help them navigate that as well. So you probably have seen the criteria that we use kind of to figure out, do we trust something? But honestly, I mean, I think it's difficult for lower level learners to be able to do a lot of this. But helping people see, is it factual information and where does that information come from? Is there any research behind it? Analyzing a website to see if it sells a product is really good information. Has it been updated recently? Like, especially with COVID, right? Updates were happening on an hourly basis almost. And so we don't want to be looking at something about COVID or vaccines from 2020 when things have changed so much in 2021. Can you use the site without making an account? Is another thing. If somebody has to provide a lot of their information, then that's not usually good. Who pays for the site? Who is the author? Are other good things. But when I'm working with adult learners, I think we can really focus on what is the ending of the website and really direct people to go to .gov, .edu, and .org. So in the course, we follow the Harris family as they kind of do an internet search. So we try to do a real-time search and help people learn how to navigate a web page and again, find the good health information. So her diagnosis, Ms. Harris's, was hypertension. And so again, in this real-time kind of Google search, it gets typed into the box and then we talk about the elements on this page. Now, when we use Google, for diseases like this, where we use the specific medical term, it really does return some pretty good results. So you can see here, we've got pictures. We have Mayo Clinic, which is a highly regarded website, is at the top. We have what looks like a dictionary listing here on the right. We have some other search terms that people could look for. So, you know, when we use, again, those terms, it has really improved in terms of the types of returns we get back on our initial page and even initial couple of pages. So this is a listing that also kind of came after that top page I just showed you. And you can see almost all of these are .org, .gov. So in the course, we kind of go through and talk about the differences with those endings. WebMD would be an exception. You know, WebMD is a commercial website. So while they have some good information, that is not one of the sites that I recommend that people use. I also think they have symptom checkers that can lead people to that, as we were talking about earlier, the undue distress. We also, in the course, talk about search terms, which is really important, right? The more specific that we can be in our search terms, the more targeted results that we will get. And so I just, even like working with my teenagers, I can see that they sometimes have a hard time really focusing in on what they want, and they get frustrated and they waste a lot of time. So for instance, for Ms. Harris, if she put in high blood pressure treatment for women, even her age maybe, maybe her ethnicity, the more specific she could be, the more targeted results that she would get. So we also talk about ads, which again is really important for making sure that people realize what AD means and what .com means. So .com is commercial. And a lot of people don't think of it that way because it's so common, but commercial means anybody can have that site and make any claims that they want to make. So I want you to take a second to minimize Zoom and do your own internet search for the term flat tummy. So you can kind of go out of your full screen and take a look, and I'm going to do it on my screen too. Just to give you kind of an example of the difference between what we just looked at with hypertension and what it looks like when we have kind of something that is more slang. Can you guys see that screen? Can you confirm that for me, Nicole?
Yes, we can see it.
Awesome, thank you. So when we looked at hypertension, remember we had the Mayo Clinic providing us with information. On the right-hand side, we had a dictionary that was defining terms for us. But look what we get when we put in flat tummy. Everything is an ad, right? So I think it's really important to help adult learners and all of us understand exactly what that means. So here we have an ad by flattummy.co.com. Okay, but this isn't an ad, this is just a result that came up, right? And here on the right, we have all these different products that we can purchase. Another thing, and tell me in the chat if this is true. So we're gonna talk about algorithms in a minute, but you might get different results than I get, right? Based on our history of what we search, and a lot of other factors. So that's another really interesting thing to look at. And sometimes if you go to a website a certain number of times with the cookies, it will even offer you different information based on the number of times that you come to the site. So, you know, it's gotten pretty complex in terms of what we find. So implications for you after you just did the search, don't hate me. But even one search for a topic or product can begin to change your internet search listings and ads, and you might start to see those changes across multiple devices. So if I search something on my home computer, then I might start to see it on my phone, I might see it on my iPad. Really interesting too, for those of you who have a partner, you know, when my spouse searches for something, it shows up as well in my algorithms because we, you know, have somehow been linked in social media, which makes it really difficult at Christmas time, right? Because I can tell what he's searching to buy me as a gift. So they are tracking every single click that we make. We call these algorithms when they kind of use computer code to take all the information that you give them, and then they make predictions on what you like and what you will want to interact with. because really whether we're talking about websites or social media, the key is trying to get people to interact, because the more interactions there are, the more chance there is to see ads and the more money there is to be made, right? So I think we just all need to realize, and I think most of us do, but we need to share with adult learners too, that that's happening all the time with everything that we click, websites or social media. So this process was pulling the filter bubble. And I'd love to see in the chat, what are some potential problems you think might be associated with these algorithms? What is this filter bubble that we're talking about? How can the algorithm kind of focus in on certain topics and not other topics? So I'd love to hear your kind of opinions about that. And I see that there's a little talk about North Star, and we'll talk about that in just a couple of minutes. Sorry, I'm getting ahead. So that's kind of what we do with searching, just using the internet for health information. But as I was saying, you know, using trustworthy websites is a great place to direct students. So there's different categories of these, US and state government sites, public library, medical libraries, medical clinics and hospitals, and nonprofit health organizations are all good places for people to get information. So here's some examples of government websites. Medline Plus is one that I really like. It's plain language. There's a lot of pictures. There's a lot of videos. I think it's a great resource for people who are learning English or are learning more basic skills. CDC is definitely good, but you sometimes have to dig deep to find their plain language information. NIH, National Institutes of Health as well, has some good plain language information. So definitely that's a reliable resource that we can send students to. Public libraries and medical libraries are another good resource. So this is the Medical Library Association consumer health page, and it has website recommendations for all different types of conditions. So you can see on here, cancer, heart disease, all different types of diagnosis or questions that people might have. They have plain language websites listed on this page, and I'll put that on our resource sheet as well. Health associations and nonprofits would be another good site. Medical clinics and hospitals. So Mayo Clinic, Cleveland Clinic, there's some, you know, really great large hospital systems that provide good plain language information and allow people to search by terms. So what about Facebook, YouTube, TikTok, and Twitter? You know, we're starting to see more and more people getting some of their health information from these sources. And, you know, it's definitely a concern. So here's a couple of TikToks that I pulled off the web that I just wanted to kind of get an example. So if we do that search as we talked about for flat stomach, I'll play it real quick. Oh, for all of my pretty and all of my ugly too. I love to see me from your point of view. I wanna trust me. The way that you trust me. So we're seeing more and more companies paying people to develop content, right? But it's very personalized content. So it's, again, we follow the money. It's important to realize that likely this person has a sponsorship with this dieter's tea, and that's why she's making these different TikToks. So if somebody's algorithm though is kind of making it so they see a lot of these types of videos, then it's, you know, the dream of marketing when we keep reinforcing the same product or the same idea over and over again. And social media and internet algorithms do that, right? Keeps reinforcing the same messages. So here's another one about blood pressure.
Okay, let's talk high blood pressure. Probably one of the most common ailments that my Latino people face, along with diabetes. But healing this is so simple. The thing that holds most of us back is the discipline and the stubbornness. So first and foremost, you're gonna let go of the meat and follow this exact diet. This is gonna help fix up those kidneys, which is the main problem. You're gonna go ahead and grab these herbs off of Amazon or Etsy. Then you're gonna go over to my website and grab this, my Trinity Detox Package. Now I'll tell you why I recommend this. Not only does it target your gut to cleanse that out, which is most likely how your problem started, but it also has a kidney formula in there that will relieve that pressure and get those kidneys functioning again.
So I don't know about you, but it concerns me that this fellow is making claims about kidney function and cleaning out kidneys. You know, some of these supplements can really cause harm to the body. NIH, for example, has a great supplement website where people can look up some of these supplements, but they really can cause harm. And so, you know, again, if we keep seeing this product over and over again, then people start to have a false sense that it's safe.
Okay, let's talk.
So here's one more I wanted to show you, which is kind of the flip side of that last one. And yes, these are diuretics, a lot of these products, or they can also cause other gastrointestinal problems.
If you have high blood pressure, here's some things you can do about it. Number one, exercise, at least 30 minutes of moderate intensity exercise 5 days out of the week. Number two, diet, more than just a low sodium diet. There's something called the DASH diet. You can Google it, but basically it's a diet that's high in fruits and vegetables, low in added salt, saturated fat, and added sugar. Number three, if you drink alcohol, do so only in moderation. Heavy alcohol use raises blood pressure. And number four, if you're a little bit heavier, even just moderate weight loss, 5 to 10 pounds, can make a big difference in controlling blood pressure. But for some people, even if they do all that stuff right, their blood pressures are still too high. And in those cases, you can talk to your doctor and get on some good medications. If you have
look at the difference between the first one and this one. So the first one, the guy's like, it's easy, right? No problem. So this person is claiming quite evidently to be a doctor, right? He's got a huge badge, but we don't know if he is a doctor. So at least he's giving better advice, but we still have to be skeptical, right? Unless we can authenticate somebody. So he mentioned, for instance, the DASH diet. So what I would recommend an adult learner do is use the skills that we talked about, use the websites talked about, and look up the DASH diet. That actually is a true diet. That is designed to help people with blood pressure and has some good research behind it. So if we can help give people the skills and then to encourage them to use those skills no matter where they're getting the information, there's kind of some consistency there. So I know I'm running short on time. So I'll go through this last couple slides pretty quickly. But again, what I was just saying, you know, encourage people to ask their doctors, think about what action the poster wants you to, not poster, is the actual poster of the social media. The first blood pressure guy, he wanted us to go to his website, right? He wanted us to buy products. So if we could kind of think about why people are posting the information they're posting, that can help us to understand whether it's something that we should believe in or not. So one last concept I want to talk about is content shock. And I think we've all been experiencing this, but there is a level of information in which we will all shut down and our brains will shut down. I would argue that's kind of happened with COVID now, and a lot of people just don't want to hear anything about it, don't want to read about it, they're tired of it. So we do have to recognize that and try to encourage people not to over research topics, to look for a few good sites and then stick to that and try not to kind of take in everything that's coming from all of these different resources, because then we get overload and we're less likely to be critical when we're kind of thinking about topics. So a few themes just to kind of wrap up with adult learners, understanding that social media platforms are businesses as well as many of the internet platforms. So the goal is profit, that companies are getting smarter and smarter about marketing through algorithms. Profits are driven by having users stay engaged. And the longer they're there, the more ads they will see. And that the ethics and rules concerning a lot of this, as we've seen in the media, has not been determined by our society. So there's still a lot of evolution in terms of what's okay and what's not. So I encourage you to take a look at our course that covers a lot of these topics, but in more basic information. And as I mentioned, using telehealth is another important one. Finding access to local low-cost healthcare resources is another great topic. So students could do some investigations on this, make PowerPoints or brochures or videos as a project-based learning idea. So one last thing I want to say, and then I'll take it for questions. We did just release our call for health literacy applications this week. So if you're interested in trying to incorporate digital health literacy into your curriculum, we do have training and funding available to adult literacy organizations throughout the state to do that. So take a look on our website. The due date for this application is February 4th, and we'll be having a prospective applicant webinar on January 10th from 11 to 11:45. And all the information about the application details and how to sign up for that webinar are located on our website. So if anybody has any questions, feel free to send me an email.
Okay, very good. Well, thank you, Heather, and thank you, Kathy. Would it be possible, Heather, to put the web link in on that, the application?
Absolutely.
Or blue application, very good. Okay, well, we just have a couple minutes, but I wanted to open it up for questions. And I think we did have one here from Jenny. How have you handled learners that don't have the basic literacy skills to access North Star? Do you have a scaled down or modified digital literacy resource? And I do appreciate that Jeremy actually took a stab at answering that, but was there anything that you two would like to add?
Well, I mean, the nice thing to do with something like that is match somebody up with a tutor, right? Where they can sit together and go through it together and help the learner develop some confidence is what I would recommend.
Okay. And if there's any other questions, you can either unmute yourself or put it in the chat. While we're doing that, I do want to thank the Florida Department of Education, Division of Career and Adult Education for making this session possible. We really appreciate all their support. We also will be sharing, Nicole, if you can share the session evaluation, we'd love it if you could take a few minutes after the session here and just give us your feedback on this session. We certainly appreciate that. And I also wanted to mention that we are extending our deadline for the Florida Literacy Coalition call for presenters. So if any of you in-state or out are interested in potentially presenting at Florida Literacy Conference, our conference is going to be April 27th through 29th here in Orlando at the Florida Hotel. So we'll add a link in the chat on that as well. Let's see, any other questions? I guess I don't see any here. So with that, I think we'll go ahead and wrap it up. Thank you again, Kathy and Heather. Lots of great information. You've given us lots of good resources and food for thought. And I just want to wish you all a happy and safe holiday season. So you all take care.
Thanks, everybody. Thanks so much. Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Bye now.